Hi, I'm going to read some information on the inventor Paul Pantone fuel processing system for gasoline powered engines. You can Google search GEET International homepage, and that should take you to information. This more information about the GEET system. GEET stands for Global Environmental Energy Technology, and I'm making this video to help everyone understand a little bit more detail about the system that may have not read through all this, but may prefer to just listen to a video rather than read the information. So here we go. The GEET, by the way, there is some misspelling, but what's important is to get the general idea. And you can always further research this just by Google searching GEET International or GEET Friends, I think is another page. Another web page you can find more information on. The GEET fuel processor is a self-inducing plasma generator. The first working prototype was developed long before the technical analysis was attempted. Plasma research is a fairly new field of acceptable science. At this time, most printed text is from foreign countries, and a majority from Russia. The technology used in the GEET fuel processor is a combination of the most basic scientific principles, most of which falls within the normal rules and rules of thermodynamics, but some of the 70 simultaneous phenomena are not found in those books, since it is the combination of events which is the body of this discovery. Put quite simply, the exhaust heat is transferred to the incoming fuel vapor, which must be maintained in a vacuum. And the overall configuration provides a molecular breakdown within the vacuum of all of the heavier elements, therefore intensifying the vacuum. The speed of molecular breakdown or reaction is magnified, and less heat is required. The GEET plasma unit generates several electrical fields at the same time while operating, some of which are in opposite direction, and all are affected by the direction of mass movement as well as by the gravitational field of our planet. During lectures from coast to coast, Paul and Molly have explained that it is frequency and vibration that determines the amount of plasma or energy being developed. Research in private laboratories in Europe is helping to isolate some of the basic field replication of the plasma generator that the Pantones need for visible demonstrations. Many attempts to use the external electrical mechanical devices to enhance the production of plasma in the GEET fuel processor have all failed to show any promise, such as the plasmatron. This has occurred because the outside interference has opposed the natural order of the energy, which must be self-generated to maximize the results, as well as will increase the charge discharge at specific needs of demand of the plasma or GEET gas. It should also be noted that using outside non-natural heating diminishes the fields which are normally self-generated. The specific movement of vapor within the GEET fuel processor is focused to exact flow direction and velocity being self-created, thereby maximizing and intensifying the field and enhancing the molecular or atomic disassociation, without all other natural elements increasing to equal proportions. One cannot expect that merely increasing the arc field will be the main reason for specific success of any given substance to be broken down to its base elements. When the ideal plasma has been created, is the time to begin increasing or decreasing all parameters involved at their respective equal or balanced increments to satisfy an increase or decrease in the plasma flow. In doing so, one can increase the plasma flow to a viable delivery state for all commercial use demands. During tests, the over-revving to engines has startled engineers and scientists from around the world. As engines are sped up to over twice the normal RPMs and slowed down to a fraction of their normal idle speed with no noticeable vibration. Have you ever seen a 350 Chevrolet engine idle at 80 RPMs? We have. A 350 Chevrolet, by the way, is the size of the engine. All of the currently studied plasma generators basically share a design and operational feature in that they attempt to push the fuel under pressure into a reaction, whereby a need for outside energy to force the device to function. The most unique feature of the GEET plasma fuel system is that by supplying the fuel into the plasma chamber in a vacuum, and through a longitudinal natural release, causes a radial reaction which is self-induced, which creates energy as electrons are pulled into the reacting of plasma instead of consuming energy. Thus the plasma becomes more homogenized with atmospheric air, causing a well-blended fuel for final delivery. An additional stabilizing feature within our system is the natural circulation of opposing masses as a vorticular motion within the plasma field, a condition as described by Molly Pantone as thermal momentum or inertia. Such field is caused in part by the chamber beginning before and after the field zone. The size of the field zone must coincide with the fuel and parameters with specific limitations dependent on the fuel demand. Now we should also explain that a small unit such as a 10 horsepower engine can be used as a servant to produce fuel to be used by an unmodified larger engine or furnace by adapting pumps and only modifying the air intake only. Thus, a 10 horsepower engine could make the fuel for a locomotive. The exact length of the plasma chamber need be adjusted to fully accommodate rapid change of fuels when different blends are being used. This is quite simple but requires some very expensive equipment for analysis of the final exhaust for the average mechanic. The balance point of a perfectly adjusted GEET plasma reaction chamber will give the same temperature coming out of the exhaust pipe as the ambient air, as well as the air quality should be same or a slight increase of oxygen coming out of the tailpipe. So far, the inventor has accomplished a 2% increase in oxygen coming out of an internal combustion engine using crude oil as fuel, and a 3.5% increase using battery acid mixed with 80% salt water. At the higher than ambient oxygen levels, you normally find ice forming on the exhaust pipes as a normal function of this phenomenon. When the plasma field chamber is too short or too long for the density of the fuel being used, it overheats the south end and chills the north end of the reactor. This also causes the fuel to consume oxygen instead of creating it. The direction and configuration of the heat source is critical to the proper balance of the reaction to create a plasma. We have now learned that down is the same as south in relation to relationship to using a compass, and therefore north is up. Other plasma generators, such as the copycat from MIT, which they call the plasmatron, uses outside applied power to create heat to run the units, but have extremely limited use and output when compared to the GEET system. Since the power output of plasma is constant and generates power, we can only assume that it is of a DC nature and is a constant output which we have not yet attempted to harness, hopefully coming soon. Excuse me. There will be a large number of reports dating back to 1984 that the inventor was not ready to release until he felt the timing was right. He feels the timing is now right, and these will be posted as soon as possible. If you would like to share some of your experience with the inventor, contact him at info@geet.com. I believe that's it for this page. Okay, here is GEET International Institute by Paul Pantone. This is more information. Okay, this is a picture of, I believe this is the center rod inside the reaction chamber. I'll read this to you. It says Molly Effect, named in honor of his wife Molly. And then it says Aura, or Molly Effect. It says many believe that the field around the reactor rod after its use was not truly a magnetic one, but one of a human aura. This is a case, and further testing is being conducted at various locations around the world. You may use glass, aluminum, or steel for the rod, and you will still have the aura. Which is to say, it'll still have the magnetic field after it's been used. Just to clarify, these do not have a magnetic field when you first put the rod in. After it's been running for 20 minutes, it'll then have a magnetic field. This is based on what I've read and researched. Okay. Transmutation of elements. I don't know if this is in focus or not. I can't change the focus while the camera's running. It says, so basically we have this is the reaction taking place, okay? Now what's coming through here is the fuel, the GEET gas. I guess the GEET gas is on this side. This is just the fuel vapors. And then the GEET gas is when it's exiting, coming out of this side of the reaction chamber. This is what's being burnt in the internal combustion engines cylinders. So I'm going to read the information that's giving. It says reaction. This is a solid rod here. South and north. This is how it becomes magnetized after the engine has first run for 20 minutes. This is carbon equals C12 on the top. This is sulfur equals S32. This is one example of a reaction that takes place. I don't know what fuels were being used for this, but this is based on this going in, and then this is what's coming out. 6HE or 12H on top, and then it says 16HE or 32H on the bottom. And then here it says any combination that equals the atomic weight of the original element. Okay, on the bottom it says, during tests since 1983, the amount of carbon found coming from the GEET reactor chamber was always lower. In some cases, the complete absence of carbon creates an abundance of O2. 23.4% O2 has been found in the final exhaust while using crude oil as the main fuel. The axis of the Earth has north-south, north-south pole. On the bottom it says, excess electrons are pulled through the planet to the north and are dispelled as the aurora borealis, northern lights. Reducing the exhaust flow increase the vacuum in the exhaust from engine. Okay, the top picture here is showing what they're changing here is just the size of the exhaust pipe that the rod and fuel flow goes through. So the green rod here carries the fuel. The little red rod in the center, I'll just call it the reactor rod. I don't know what the formal word for that is. That rod is what the fuel goes around, squeezes past on the top and bottom and all around, squeezes through there. Now, this is showing that purple. It looks purple to me. This is where the exhaust is going through to heat up and react with. I don't know if it's heating up, but we'll say it's reacting. This hot exhaust is reacting in here with this fuel. Okay. Now this is important to note also that the fuel is traveling in this picture from left to right. The rod in the center of that fuel pipe is sharp on this end and it's flat on this end. Okay, it's sharp on this end and the fuel's going into that sharp tip and then squeezing around the sides of it over here. Okay, now the exhaust is flowing the opposite direction, this way. The exhaust is flowing this way, okay? Now I'm gonna read this over here to you. Adjustments. Larger exhaust area to prevent restrictive back pressure. Consequences, reduced efficiency. Okay, now the second picture down here. This is three different pictures. Second picture, and the only thing that changes in these three pictures, by the way, is the size of the exhaust pipe. That's it. The center green pipe does not change, and neither does the rod, and this is the very middle of that pipe either. Just the exhaust pipe size in this area on these three. Okay, the second picture, adjustments. Same exhaust area allowing restriction for back pressure. Consequences, good efficiency. So when they say same, I believe they mean that the pipe here is the same diameter here as it is up here and here. Whereas in the first picture, it's one size here and then gets bigger all over here and then small here again. Okay. Now in the third picture, adjustments. Shrink exhaust area to add restrictive back pressure. Consequences, maximized efficiency. Okay, so hypothetically speaking, let's call this a 2-inch. And these numbers are completely just for, I'm just saying this as an example. I'm still learning about this technology myself. If the exhaust pipe is 2 inches, then it gets smaller than that here in this area. Okay? They're restricting the exhaust flow. But that helps somehow with the efficiency of the fuel that's coming the opposite direction through this pipe. Okay? It helps. It says maximized efficiency. Again, adjustments on the third picture down. Shrink exhaust area to add restrictive back pressure. Consequences, maximized efficiency. Now here it says 7.8 hg of vacuum right here. Okay. 7.8 hg of vacuum, causing 20 to 30% increase in gross horsepower. So the exhaust is flowing this way, and there's a 7.8 hg vacuum there. Okay. Maximized efficiency. It says by 20 to 30% increase in gross horsepower. Okay. Bottom says, this restriction causes the exhaust stroke of the engine to become a power stroke by electrical means, which needs further study. GEET fuel only fires in the exact center of the piston. So it's showing that it fires here and explodes outward equally in every direction. And that's Cambridge Labs, Canada, is where I believe the testing was done. Okay, this must be a misspelling. I don't know how to read these words here. Because GEET fuel is a perfect burn and blends better than conventional fuels, it will ignite from the center of the piston and move outward, causing much less wear and vibration to any engine. Thermal inertia or momentum. This diagram is showing that if you have 40 degree water and 200 degree water, these containers placed in a refrigerator at 38 degrees, at 25 minutes time, this 40 degree water will have reached 39.5 degrees, and the 200 degree water will have reached 32 degrees. So my understanding of this is that they're saying that water that is much hotter, seeming almost accelerates inertia or momentum and passes up the cold temperature of the water that was only at 40 degrees. I have not looked into this. I'm still learning. I'm just reading the graph, okay? I've discussed this with people and they've told me that they understand this, that they've heard of this as well. At 25 hours, both will reach 38 degrees. So I believe that what it's saying is that it takes 25 hours for them to actually reach 38 degrees. Okay. The bottom reads, a mass of higher temperature differential will achieve a more rapid movement to the cooler and will surpass the mean temperature of the cooler because of this thermal momentum. Everything that I'm reading to you relates to the GEET, some of the processes that are taking place in the GEET system. It somehow relates. Want more? This is only some of the 190 phenomena that are attributed to the GEET process. You can't at this time order the full presentation or sign up as a student by sending an email to info@geet.com. Credits, PowerPoint demonstration created by John L. Close, 12789 North Rio Vista Road. Okay. Drawings by Clarence H. Close Jr. Okay. GEET, Global Environmental Energy Technologies presents the reactor assembly. The main components of the GEET reactor assembly are the rod, the inlet chamber, and the outlet chamber. Each has a specific part to play in the reaction process. The assembly is typically made of steel, much like a standard exhaust system on your engine. First, there will be the basic reactor rod inside the reactor. So this is the reactor rod. That's the small rod right there in the center, right there. Okay. The arrows are, by the way, are showing, the green arrows are pointing that the fuel will be flowing this way and squeezing by the rod here. Okay, that's the center pipe right there. And then this, the opposite direction will be the exhaust, hot exhaust flowing this way in a larger pipe, okay? In here, through and out this way. And the center pipe will be sealed here and here, so the exhaust will not leak out. These are two separate pipes, one carrying fuel this way, the other carrying the hot exhaust this way, the opposite direction. And the rod will be pointed at this side. It'll be sharp at this side and flat on this side. That's my understanding of from what I've read. And that's, I don't know the reasons for that exactly. I do not recall exactly. I just recall this, what I'm saying to you. Okay, first there will be the basic reactor rod inside the reactor. Next will be the vapor inlet piping. Okay, so they're calling this the vapor inlet piping. That's where the fuel vapors, the gasoline vapors, or whatever you put in there, used motor oil, used transmission fluid, up to 80% water, I've read, just tap water, salt water, mixed with pickle juice and Mountain Dew and Coca-Cola. People are mixing all kinds of different liquids in there, as long as there's some either oil, used engine oil, or gasoline or alcohol, rubbing alcohol in there. I believe the system, if it's designed correctly, will run. Okay, next will be the vapor inlet piping. Finally, the exhaust outlet piping. This is showing the exhaust outlet piping here. And the exhaust flow with the little red arrow, hard to see in the camera, but it goes, it's showing that the exhaust will flow this way. Out here. In here, out here. The hole here is for the last image we saw, which I believe was the reactor rod chamber. Yes. The vapor inlet piping, they're calling it. Okay, that's what that hole right there is. It's for that. The whole assembly is complete. Now it's showing it complete together. And it's showing the flow of the fuel. Fuel vapor going this way, in that center, the tiny center pipe, and the larger outer pipe is the exhaust, flowing the opposite direction. Okay. Please note the green vapor inlet and red exhaust arrows. So they're pointing out again, the direction is extremely important for the reaction. Okay. Exhaust this way. Fuel vapors this way. For understanding, you can see the relationship of the rod to the exhaust piping. Okay, so they're showing the exhaust piping. They're showing you that with the green arrows that the fuel goes this way. Here is the rod, which will be sharp on this end, flat on this end. This one here is not very sharp, but I've seen and read that this will be pointed and sharp on this end. Here it's more rounded, but it will be, you would want that to be more sharp. I believe that's my understanding on what I've read. A section view locates the rod exactly centered in the exhaust gas stream. Okay. The rod exactly centered. So not over here, not over here, it's right in the center of the exhaust gas stream. So they're saying they want that rod right in the center. Okay, exhaust flow, fuel vapor flow. This way. Okay. and exhaust flow this way. There must be counterflow of incoming vapors and outgoing exhaust for heat exchange. So here again, they're showing the hot exhaust going this way, and the fuel vapors going this way. And the fuel vapors will squeeze around this rod. Okay? So there will be a small gap. That rod will have a little space. I do not know the exact measurements. You'll have to contact Paul Pantone or research that further. Drawings and presentations by Close Technologies. Clarence H. Close Jr. Okay. GEET. Global Environmental Energy Technology. Single auto conversion plans. So these plans are meant to be used to convert one automobile. And this, I'm reading this for informational purposes only, and I'm just reading this for strictly for informational purposes. Warning, this information is classified as experimental. Keep in mind that Paul Pantone, the inventor, has been working on this for 34 years, perfecting the technology. Okay, I'm going to read this to you. Strictly for informational purposes, I'm reading this to you now. Auto conversion plans, and this was found on the internet, for information to help people understand. It's how I found this myself, is in researching and learning more. Okay. March 2001 edition, artwork enhanced by exotic research. Table of contents. What is a GEET fuel processor? Engine conversion overview diagram, liquid to vapor phase changer, bubbler round drawing, bubbler square drawing, bubbler float drawing, the reaction chamber drawing, air management valve, AMV, air management valve drawing, air management valve delayed valve drawing, final notes, inventor profile, additional plans available, tech support registration form, GEET technical information. When I went to this www.geet.nl, the page did not open, so I would recommend going to geetinternational.com. That's where I found a lot of information. And just Google searching in various GEET, different GEET information on Google. Okay, so let me go back up. GEET, Global Environmental Energy Technology. The following plans are designed to help you retrofit your internal combustion engines with the GEET fuel processor technology. The diagram drawings represent working designs of basic individual parts and components needed for manually operated retrofit applications of both small and automotive type engines. Once you understand how the technology and application works on your engine manually, you should be able to better understand what will be needed to change it over to an automated system. Changes or variations of design may be necessary to fit your specific needs. Example, flange modifications, parts placement, space limitations, etc. As long as the principles of the GEET technology are adhered to and all system components are incorporated as specified, your retrofit application should function properly. Warning, this information is classified as experimental. We cannot guarantee results. Please take time to educate yourself sufficiently before proceeding. The following is for information purposes only. We do not control the materials used in construction, the methods of, nor the applications of construction or use of the finished product. Therefore, we are not responsible for dangerous or undesirable results, and we do not take responsibility for accidents due to negligence or ignorance. Warning, gasoline is extremely flammable. Caution should always be used when working around it. Do not smoke around it and keep it away from open flames. Whenever possible, use goggles, gloves, and or other protective gear. And I personally, reading this, recommend always having at least one full fire extinguisher with you. That's my recommendation if you're experimenting. Always have a fire extinguisher. And a water hose if possible. Fire extinguisher is better though. Oftentimes. What is a GEET fuel processor? The GEET fuel processor, GFP, is a fuel refinery, plasma fuel generator, and fuel delivery system all rolled into one. I'm going to read that again. The GEET fuel processor is a fuel refinery, plasma fuel generator, and fuel delivery system all rolled into one. The GEET fuel processor is capable of dramatically increasing the efficiency and decreasing the pollution of an internal combustion engine. The GEET fuel processor is also capable of using diverse fuels that the engine would normally not tolerate. For many applications, the GEET retrofit can pay for itself in a short period of time. The GEET fuel processor operates on the principle of hot and cold air masses moving in opposite directions within a vacuum. By running the fuel vapor up through the center of the exhaust in the opposite direction of the exhaust flow, we are simulating these air masses. The reaction rod in the GEET fuel processor acts like a synthetic Mother Earth. As the masses shear against each other, friction causes the formation of electrical charges, and the atmosphere around these charges become ionized. Plasma forms as lightning within the reaction chamber, causing whatever fuel being used to transmutate into a cleaner, simpler based new fuel we call GEET gas. With the GEET fuel processor, fossil fuels would no longer be as polluting or harmful to the environment as before, and the terminology usable fuel would take on a whole new meaning. To better understand how the GEET fuel processor works, let's look at the smaller subsystems, of which there are three. 1. Liquid to vapor phase changer. The GEET fuel processor reactor utilizes a vaporized fuel, not a liquid fuel. Therefore, we must incorporate a means to change the liquid fuel by means of a phase change into a vapor. The drier the vapor, the better. A bubbler or even a modified carburetor can sufficiently deliver an aerosol, which is small droplets of liquid fuel mixed with air, to the reaction chamber. The heavier the fuels, the more difficult it is to vaporize them. Between the two, the bubbler has delivered the better results when using heavier or diverse fuels. The bubbler also seems to be more efficient in the vaporization of fuel, but the modified carburetor is easier to work with and has its own float system built in. For ongoing operation, the bubbler requires a float system set up to regulate its fuel level. 2. Reaction chamber. This is a pipe within the center of the exhaust system which utilizes a heat transfer or plasma reaction to break the fuel down into a simpler, cleaner form before it is fed into the engine. By running fuel vapor up through the center of the exhaust in the opposite direction of the exhaust flow, we are simulating a natural phenomena of hot and cold air masses colliding. This collision within a vacuum helps create the desired reaction needed in the GEET fuel processor. Air management valve 3, AMV. The new GEET fuel coming from the reaction chamber must be properly mixed with additional incoming fresh air. As it is metered into the engine, this is the job of the air management valve. This can be as simple as using two ball valves, or as complicated as machining the unit shown in these plans, or one of your own design. The basic GEET method. So it's saying liquid to vapor phase changer. Vaporized air fuel mixture. Reaction chamber. GEET gas going this way. Air management valve. And then final application. And then here we have air going into this liquid to vapor phase changer going this way as well. And then air also going into air management valve. So this is showing air going both ways. That's just air, the air we're breathing, going into these two separate parts here. Excuse me. We have diagrammed a manual operated air management valve for small engine use and a lever controlled unit for the large engines. Understand that you have the freedom to mix and match styles and designs to best suit your application needs, space requirements, and your individual abilities. For security and protection reasons, we are not including the specific clearances for each application. You will need to call Paul Pantone to get these specifications. When built properly, the GEET fuel processor should work as promised, and in most instances may exceed your expectations. As a side note, I know that Paul Pantone offers help with these systems for a small fee, small donation fee, I believe it is. I'm not certain of that. You have to confirm that for yourself. Air management valve, AMV. Reactor. The three major components making up a GEET device, and bubbler. So it's saying bubbler, which I believe is, well, in this drawing, I'm not actually quite certain. This says bubbler. This says air management valve. I believe this is the air management valve here. Reactor, I believe is, it must be in here. And bubbler, I believe is this unit here. This here says Holly Float Bowl Assembly in small writing. Liquid to vapor phase changer. Two methods of phase changing liquid fuel into a vapor are bubblers and modified carburetors. Basic bubbler operation. One of the two methods of phase changing the liquid fuel into a vapor is a bubbler. Included in this set of plans are three drawings of bubblers. Each has advantages and disadvantages, so it will be up to you to study them and choose which is right for your application needs. Air is drawn into the bubbler through the inlet at the top and goes through a tube to the bottom of the bubbler, where it escapes and bubbles up to the surface of the liquid. As that air bubbles up through the liquid fuel, it creates vapors in the top portion of the bubbler, which are pulled into the reaction chamber by the vacuum of the engine. And I want to note here, from what I've read, it's important that the exhaust is not pressurizing the fuel and forcing it into the intake of the engine, but rather it's important that there's a vacuum where the engine is actually pulling a negative pressure, pulling the vapors into the intake. That's my understanding, and that's extremely important, because without that negative pressure vacuum, when I say negative pressure, I mean lower than atmospheric pressure. It's actually pulling the fuel in. That's my understanding. I just wanted to say that because that's something that surprised me, that I was happy to have understood. I'll continue reading here. A diffuser, bubbler plate, and or metal scrub pads placed in the bubbler will help break up the larger bubbles into smaller ones to produce better vapors. Enriching the fuel mixture to the reaction chamber. Other types of bubblers can be used also. The liquid level within the bubbler should never be high enough to allow liquids to be sucked into the reaction chamber. Only the vapors are allowed in the reaction chamber for the process to work properly. Mechanical float. For continuous running applications, you will need to control the fluid level in the bubbler. One way of doing this is to attach a Holley float chamber to the side of the bubbler as shown in the drawings. This is a mechanically operated system that can sufficiently do the job. If you use this method, the surface of the bubbler you are attaching the chamber to must be flat. A fuel bowl adapter shown on drawing can be made to connect the chamber to a round bubbler. You will need to drill out 5 or 6 1/4-inch holes across the bottom area of the bubbler where the chamber attaches, so liquid can flow from the float chamber to the bubbler. Another 3 or 4 holes should be drilled Three or four holes should be drilled in the bubbler at the top area of the float chamber to equalize pressure between the two chambers. Electrical float. Another way of controlling the fluid level would be an externally mounted electric float switch. See drawing AC-003. This could be adapted to either shaped bubbler. Parts needed are electric float switch, a horn relay, a propane shutoff solenoid, 2-inch PVC pipe with solid end caps, 16 to 18 gauge wire, screw-in brass hose fittings, 5/16 inch fuel line, and hose clamps. The electric float switches available are for very low amperage. The amount of power required to activate the propane shutoff solenoid would burn out most float switches. Therefore, we use a relay activated by the float switch to activate the shutoff solenoid. The principle used here is that fluids will seek their own level. Therefore, the level of fluid in an externally mounted chamber will be consistent with the level in the bubbler. The advantage is that the level in the float switch will not be as affected by the constant bubbling action that takes place in the bubbler. Adjust the float switch within the chamber to the desired height of fluid in the bubbler. Raising the fluid level in the bubbler can give a richer mixture. But remember not to allow any liquids to be sucked into the reactor. Maintaining a fluid level approximately 1 to 2 inches over the bubbler diffuser plate should give good results. You will need to experiment and determine what works best at your altitude. You may find that a fuel pump isn't necessary. The vacuum within the bubbler may be sufficient to pull the fuel into the bubbler. A disadvantage to this is that too much fuel may be pulled into the bubbler if your shutoff valve doesn't seal properly. Temperature effects. During the phase change from liquid to vapor, you will notice that your bubbler will become very cold using gasoline. This should be the first fuel you use because it is the easiest to use. The lighter elements in the gasoline will vaporize at room temperature, but the heavier elements will resist vaporization due to the cold atmosphere created. Eventually, you will vaporize all of the lights and end up with a bubbler full of what normally might be referred to as dead gas. These heavier elements, along with other fuels such as diesel, kerosene, crude oil, etc., will require the bubbler to be heated to enhance their full vaporization. Heating can be accomplished most effectively by surrounding the bubbler with the hot exhaust gases from the engine, and by directing some of the exhaust into the bubbler instead of fresh air. If you prefer, just running the exhaust gases into the bubbler instead of fresh air to create the bubbles may be sufficient for your needs. The bubbler can be constructed of metal or some plastic, such as PVC. When using plastics, make sure the glue used will not be dissolved by the fuels you will be putting into the bubbler. We have found that JB Weld epoxy is good to use. If you choose to use exhaust gases to surround and heat the bubbler, then plastic should be avoided due to the hot temperature of the exhaust. If you choose to use exhaust gases to bubble the fuel with, there are several factors to consider. When tapping into the exhaust system, come out in a Y fashion. If you T into the exhaust, there could be a siphoning effect that might suck the fuel into the exhaust. By coming out of the exhaust at an angle Y, under a slight pressure, the siphoning problem is eliminated. The line carrying the exhaust to the bubbler must, at some point, rise above the top of the bubbler to eliminate drainage back into the line upon shutdown. You must use the manual valve between the exhaust source and the bubbler inlet to control the amount of exhaust entering the bubbler to maintain a vacuum. Having the valve too far open could cause the vacuum to be lost and a pressure to be formed in the bubbler. We have noted in our testing that efficiencies can be cut to one-third by pressurizing the bubblers as opposed to having it under a vacuum. The needs of your application. Okay, I don't know why the camera stopped, but hopefully I'll be able to get this loaded up. Probably as two separate videos. So I'll back up a little bit. Let me just start over on this paragraph here. You must use the manual valve between the exhaust source and the bubbler inlet to control the amount of exhaust entering the bubbler to maintain a vacuum. Having the valve too far open could cause the vacuum to be lost and a pressure to be formed in the bubbler. We have noted in our testing that efficiencies can be cut to one-third by pressurizing the bubbler as opposed to having it under a vacuum. The needs of your application will determine the size of the manual valve, the size of the bubbler, and the size of the lines going to the bubbler and from the bubbler to the reaction chamber. If the valve or lines are too small, you may not have sufficient fuel needed for the engine to run at full power. The valve must also be closed when starting or stopping the unit to prevent fuel from being forced into the exhaust by back pressure from the engine. Okay, this diagram is showing exhaust gases. The arrows are showing a flow of this direction into the bubbler. And this is showing a flow direction of vapor flow, so this must be fuel. Yeah, this is fuel vapor. This is the bubbler. This is the fuel in here. Bubbler, fuel in here. Okay, exhaust bubbling. And then vapor only, no liquid, coming this way, going through the reactor. And this arrow is showing exhaust gases going this way, with the fuel going this way. Into here, GEET gas. It's using a different color for the GEET gas. So vapor flow, and then comes out of the reactor as GEET gas. And then fresh air in this way. And then air, GEET gas mix to engine. Down here, we're saying modified carburetor, vapor flow this way through the center pipe, and then exhaust gases going this way. Okay, fresh air in this way, air GEET gas mix to engine. AMV is, I believe that's air management valve. Okay, this too, air management valve. This says liquid to vapor phase changer overview, bubbler versus modified carburetor. So this is bubbler, this is modified carburetor. Four, finally, all of the components exposed to the heat of the exhaust must be capable of handling this heat. Most ball valves use a Teflon seal inside that will melt with the heat of the exhaust. Furthermore, if using a PVC bubbler, the exhaust would melt the plastic at the point of inlet. We have used a metal screw-in lid in both the top and bottom applications of admitting a bubbler effect into the bubbler. The metal lid will dissipate the heat into the fuel before it comes in contact with the PVC. When using the bottom method for bubbling, make sure the inlet line or tube at some point rises higher than the bubbler to prevent the liquid fuel from running back out upon shutdown of the engine. Excuse me. The valve should be placed at that higher spot also. Bubbler summary. In summary, the bubbler can be square, round, heated, not heated, tall or short. Make sure it is tall enough to keep the liquids from being sucked into the reaction line. Whatever the specific needs of your application are, will determine if you should use a bubbler and how that bubbler should be built. For constant running applications, a means of controlling the level of fuel, float chamber, external electric float unit, or something that your design yourself should be used. The large bubbles coming into the bubbler need to be broken down into smaller bubbles by the use of a bubbler diffuser plate and/or pot scrubbers. Be sure to use materials able to handle the fuels and temperatures that they will be exposed to. Either fresh, ambient, or air or exhaust gases can be bubbled up through the bubbler. The ambient air is easier to work with, but the exhaust gases may offer better results. Here they're just showing the bubbling unit. My understanding is that one of the pipes will go down to the bottom, and one of the pipes will not go to the bottom, it'll just go down a little bit right here. The fuel will be kept at a level of a couple inches above the bubbler, and you're going to want some kind of screen mesh down here that can handle high temperatures if you choose to use the exhaust heat coming in that will help break up the bubbles. That's my understanding from what I've read. Excuse me. Modified carburetors. For certain applications, a bubbler may be impractical. Space limitations or other restrictions on small engines may require you to use a modified carburetor instead. We have successfully modified and used 8 and 10 horsepower carburetors used on TECUMSEH engines to vaporize gasoline, as well as 50-50 mixtures of gas diesel and gas kerosene. We restricted the Venturi in the carburetor to pass more air over the pick-up tube. The stock carburetor is designed to deliver a 12-to-1 air-fuel ratio. For the GEET, we use a 2 or 3-to-1 air-fuel ratio. This is achieved by restricting the Venturi diameter and forcing all of the air past the fuel feed tube. This can be accomplished by either drilling a small hole on the choke side of the Venturi and mounting a baffle to direct all of the air over the discharge feed tube, or by using JB Weld epoxy to secure a washer into the Venturi, restricting the inlet. Leaving the choke on full may also help channel the air. Combinations of all of these tricks can be the mixture. Combinations of all of these tricks can make the mixture richer to deliver the necessary fuel charge for a strong and powerful reaction. The mixture adjustment screw can also be used to regulate the amount of fuel to be delivered to the reactor, helping control engine power requirements. Note, if you adjust the air-fuel mixture going to the reaction chamber too much on the rich side, economy will decrease and pollution levels will increase. Drawings of the carburetor are located in the small engine plans, as it is applicable only to the small 8 to 10 horsepower engines at this time. I'm only halfway through and I'm quite tired. It's almost 4 a.m. Not to scale. Top view. Fresh air from air meter. Air management valve. Liquid fuel coming in. Float valve area. So liquid fuel coming in, float valve area. Fuel vapor to reactor, fresh air from air management valve, and screws. These are just screws. Okay, so this is fuel vapor to reactor. So this is fuel vapor coming out. So this pipe does not go in very far. It just goes in probably 1 inch, just get an approximation. Fresh air from air management valve. Okay, so this is making a bubbler, I believe. This is making a bubbler without using the exhaust heat. Because an exhaust heat would be hot. This is just saying fresh air from air management valve. So my interpretation of what this is saying is this is bubbling with fresh air. Fuel vapor to reactor, 3/8 inch pipe, both of these, fresh air from air meter valve, 1/2 inch four cylinder and small six cylinder, 5/8 of an inch for large six cylinder and small eight cylinder engines. It says use two bubblers for large 8-cylinder engines. And then for this here, I believe it's talking about this tube here, this pipe. These measurements are for this pipe. And then this pipe is this measurement. 1/4 inch holes drilled through 3/8 pipe. Okay. Air vent holes. Several air vent and fuel inlet holes need to be drilled. and the arrow is pointing to these. Float bowl adapter here. Float bowl here. Fuel inlet hole here. Okay, so this is a side view over here. This is bubbler plate, 1/8 inch thick. Smaller to larger holes drilled to cover plate. So this plate is laying in at the bottom of this unit here. Okay. And it's going to help, these holes are going to help break up the bubbles, make them small. You want the smallest possible bubbles here. You don't want big bubbles. You want small, you want the bubbles broken up small. Okay. Okay, it says not to scale, by the way, not to scale. Materials are not critical. We have built the bubbler pots with everything from stainless steel to acrylic plastic. It says right here. Okay, fuel vapor to reactor. Okay, 3/8 inch pipe, fresh air from air meter valve, line size for air fuel, 1/2 inch fortis. I think we read this already. Use two bubblers for larger. Okay, this is 3/8 inch pipe. In the center, bubbler plate, 1/8 inch thick, smaller to larger holes drilled to cover plate. Holly float notes. Okay, this is saying Holly float bowl assembly, liquid fuel in this way. Okay, Holly float notes. Float level controls rich lean mix. The Holly float assembly is from a 4-barrel carburetor. Mounting the Holly float to the side requires drilling mounting holes. The float cannot be inside the bubbler due to bubbling action throwing the float off. This setup can also be used for small, constant run engines. So this is saying it's a front view of this unit here. Okay, I don't know if I'm going to be able to get through this whole thing. I could always continue with another video and do this tomorrow. From bubbler valve to reactor, out, pressure equalization vent tube, okay, float switch, fuel level, from fuel pump, 7 to 10 PSI max, going this way. Ignition on power. Horn relay, S, B, L. Okay, up here. Float switch is available from DWYER Instruments Incorporated, number 219-879-8800, as W.E. Anderson, part number F7-BT, and it says $16, which may have changed. Propane shutoff solenoid is available from automotive and forklift propane supply stores. Float switch is Float switch is encased in PVC pipe, 1/2 inch, 2 inch diameter, with solid end caps. Use JB field epoxy instead of PVC glue. This is propane shutoff solenoid here. The reaction chamber, the heart of the GEET fuel processor. It is the most important part, yet the easiest to build and tune. The basics of the GEET reaction. The heart of the GEET fuel processor is its reaction chamber. In a C, it is the single most important part of the entire system. Oh, in a sense, it is the single most important part of the entire system. Ironically, it is also usually the easiest part to build and tune. Most of the time, if a system isn't operating properly, it isn't the fault of the reactor, unless there are leaks. Improper fuel mixtures, vacuum leaks, too much liquid being fed into the reactor, or other things will cause problems before the reactor itself will. The following three effects must be present in the reaction chamber in order to create the reaction, assuming the hardware is correct. A. Heat. B. Vacuum on the inner chamber carrying the fuel. C. Cross flow of exhaust and FOCI. Hot in one direction, cold in the other. Upon initial startup, you will instantly have vacuum and cross flow, but not heat. Therefore, you must start the engine on a suitable fuel such as gasoline until the engine and reaction chamber reach normal operating temperatures. This can be accomplished by either putting sufficient gasoline in the fuel you desire to run, or using a separate tank for startup purpose. A valve can be placed in the fuel line to switch from the startup tank to the one you will be running off of continuously. Our advice is to keep it simple. Size and material considerations. The reaction chamber and rod placed inside need to be tuned to the size of the engine. The fuel being used, the RPM range of intended use, and whether you are using a single or dual reactor system. Generally, the exhaust pipe which surrounds the reactor chamber pipe should be sized large enough so as not to restrict the flow of exhaust from the engine. The diagram illustrates that the exhaust can be bent with the inner pipe entering and exiting straight, or the exhaust can go straight with the inner pipe entering and exiting through elbows. Steel exhaust pipe is recommended for the outer part of the reactor, and black natural gas pipe is recommended for use as the inner pipe reaction chamber, which the fuel passes through. The rod is placed in the inner pipe also. A means of holding the rod secure so it doesn't move is necessary. Twisted lengths of baling wire at both ends has worked for us and is inexpensive. Stainless steel should be avoided in all parts of the reactor. All of the parts should be of a ferrous metal, ferrous, or in other words, should be easily attracted to a magnet. This means no copper, brass, aluminum, or stainless steel. Low-grade steel dowel is what we use for the rod. The length and diameter of both inner pipe and reaction rod will only Low-grade steel dowel is what we used for the rod. The length and diameter of both inner pipe and reaction rod will only be given over the phone for the application you are building. This is done for our protection. Application notes. Remember that your exhaust gases will be exiting the engine and traveling in one direction, while the fuel will be traveling up the inner pipe in the other direction. Hot in one direction, cold in the opposite direction. The GEET fuel processor reaction chamber has shown to generate its own electromagnetic field, EMF. If applying your GEET fuel processor to a generator, route the reactor away from the generator. The electromagnetic field from the generator may interfere with the performance of your GEET fuel processor. On V-configurated engines, you can run a single reaction chamber, or run dual if you have the room. The twin setup may be the preferred method. If you don't have enough room, mount the reaction chamber downstream of the Y pipe. This enables utilization of all of the engine's waste exhaust heat. The reaction rod has three equally spaced tabs welded onto it at both ends, within 1/2 inch of the end. Either bullet shape the end of the rod or grind grooves between the tabs to create better aerodynamics for the incoming fuel. Okay, this is showing, let's see. Okay, it's showing exhaust flow through this bigger, largest pipe here. Exhaust flow this way. This is showing fuel vapor flow this way, going through the center. Fuel vapor flow, GEET gas going this way. Okay. And I think what they're saying here is, I believe they're saying you can weld little tabs on the bottom and top, or around, you know, like three tabs equally spaced around this rod to hold it perfectly in the center. So there's a small space on top and bottom holding this rod centered this way. Okay. You also need to have something keeping it from sliding out this way or this way as well. I think that's what they're showing, also showing. Yeah, so these blue dots, I believe, are showing that they're holding the rod, the center rod. It's not allowing it to move. Let's read the large engine reaction chamber here. Oh, is that another? Okay, let's see what they're saying here. Large engine reaction chamber, yes. Okay, one is copper or stainless steel tubing from bubbler. SS equals stainless steel. So one is here. Copper or stainless steel tubing from bubbler. Okay, so this is coming from the bubbler. Two is copper or stainless steel tubing to air management valve. Okay, there's two. Okay, three, brass compression or flare fitting for tubing. That's here. Four, black pipe elbow right here. Five, inner pipe of reaction chamber, call for details. Okay, five. Six, reaction rod, call for details. Seven, flared end or flange to fit exhaust line. Okay, that's here. Okay, eight. Flange to fit manifold side of exhaust line. That's here. Nine. Weld to seal. That's here. So this pipe comes through this exhaust pipe here. This pipe is going through a hole to get out, and it has to be welded tight so that the exhaust does not leak out into the air, but rather all the exhaust goes through here. So that's 9 and 9 welded here and here. Okay, 10. Exhaust pipe, 1/2 inch to 3/4 inch, larger in diameter to not restrict flow. Okay, 10. Right here. That's this. Let me read that again. Exhaust pipe, larger in diameter to not restrict flow. Okay, 11. Twisted baling wire to hold rod in place. I see. Okay, 11. So it looks like they have the wire just going from here to here, not allowing this rod to slide this way. And this wire is pushing against here and here, not allowing the rod to slide this way. So it's kind of, these wires, this baling wire is a low cost way of keeping this rod centered this way, left to right, so it's right in the center and stays there. And then these, I believe these are welds, the little dot welds. I don't think you're welding the rod in place here, but rather having these welds of metal just kind of keep this centered. So there's a space here and here. Although I've read that this can also, well, when there's fuel pressure going through here, vacuum, this will center itself just from the pressure. It'll become centered and it'll stay there while there's pressure going through there. That's what I've read. Excuse me. Air management valves. The problem child of the GEET fuel processor. It's the toughest part to build and operate. Excuse me. Air management valve operation. Of all the aspects of building the GEET fuel processor, the air management valve, AMV, is the part that may give you the most trouble when you try to adapt or build one to work automatically instead of manually. The function of the air management valve is twofold. First, to control the amount of air and fuel, and secondly, to control the engine speed and power output. For automotive engines, it is recommended that you use the multiple butterfly valve assembly shown in the drawings. This was designed to coordinate and regulate changes to the flow of air and fuel to the bubbler, reaction chamber, and to the engine necessary for use while the engine RPM constantly changes. Two valves regulate fresh, filtered air, one to the engine, A, and the other to the bubbler, B. The third valve controls the flow of the new fuel, or GEET gas, F, from the reaction chamber to the engine. In an additional butterfly valve, as shown on drawing AC-006, excuse me, may be placed in the upper portion of the air, A, channel as a delayed function butterfly that opens slower, to try and maintain constant vacuum levels in the bubbler and reaction chamber. Timing and adjustments. The air management valve mounts on the intake manifold of the engine. The three valves are linked together with adjustable linkage levers, and then to the throttle linkage of your application. The difficulty comes in adjusting the proper movement of each valve together. As the air valve needs to open wide enough to allow sufficient air to the intake manifold, the fuel valve from the reaction chamber should only open sufficiently to allow enough GEET gas to be mixed with that air. And the bubbler valve must only open far enough to allow the necessary fuel vapor to the reaction chamber, but remain closed enough to maintain the needed vacuum in the bubbler. The drawing shows levers with holes drilled and numbered. This can help you make small adjustments at a time until you get the right combination that works in your application. For instance, a connecting rod from the bubbler lever hole number 5 could be connected to the hole number 3 on the air lever, and another rod continues onto a hole on the fuel valve lever. Adjust all butterfly valves until they operate properly together. The delayed valve. To help maintain a better vacuum in the bubbler and reaction chamber, an additional butterfly valve can be incorporated in the upper part of the air channel, A, of the air management valve. This butterfly valve will be set up as a delayed action valve, which means it will open slower than the valve below it. A spring connecting the two air valve levers together will be the force trying to open the delay valve to create a resistive force. To slow the delay valve from opening, a small shock absorber from a hobby shop can be used. An alternate way of creating this resistive force sorry, I lost my spot. Resistive force would be to use an additional spring connected from an area above the delay valve and connecting to the delay lever. As the lower air valve opens up, the first spring will try to pull the lever delay valve open, while the spring above the valve resists or slows the valve from opening. Finding the proper tension springs is critical. Construction notes. Three holes should be 1 1/4 to 1 1/2 in diameter. I'm sorry, 1 1/4 to 1 1/2 inch in diameter for 350 to 460 cubic inch engines. Butterfly valve plates and shafts should be available at automotive stores for this size. The drawings are for informational purposes only. You should position the valve holes and butterfly valves in your air management valve in the order that best satisfies your applicational needs. As we develop this unit further, we can offer more help, but for now, you will have to experiment on your own. Intake adapter plate. Air cleaner bolt hole. So I guess the air cleaner would bolt on top of this, on top, and this is the hole, so you'd be tightening the screw on top, and your air cleaner would be here. Okay, connecting rods and lever. Okay, these little yellow lines are connecting rods, connecting this. This is a valve. F, A, and B, I believe, are the valves that turn and open. So when they're like this, they open. Oh, my battery's going dead in my camera. I'll just keep recording until it stops. So this is a connecting rod connecting this to this, these valves connecting to each other, and this connecting rod's connecting this to this valve. And these are adjustable. Each one is adjustable. Here's a side view. Butterfly valve lever. Hole number 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. 6 holes of adjustment. Top view. This drawing is for information purposes only. You should position the valve holes and butterfly valves in your air management valve in the order that best satisfies your applicational needs. Okay, I'm going to come back to this. I have to change the battery. Okay, brand new battery in the camera and intake adapter plate. Okay, as we were saying, air cleaner bolt hole. F, A, and B. These are valves. That open. And these are connecting rods here that connect this valve to this. And then this rod, this yellow rod, connects this valve to this. And these are all, each of these are adjustable so that these will open at different, these will maintain their relative differences between each other. I don't know how else to say that. Top view. This drawing is for information purposes only. You should position the valve holes and butterfly valves in your air management valve in the order that best satisfies your application needs. Okay, butterfly valve lever. Adjustments. Here we go. There's 1 through 6, and there's 6 adjustment holes. These are the valves that we just saw. These here are a side view of these valves. It's the top view. These circles from a side view is right here. Okay? This valve, and this valve. Okay, this says from reaction chamber. So this is GEET gas coming in. This is your vaporized gas that's been reacted in the GEET reactor chamber going in. Okay, GEET gas, we'll call it, going in this way to engine. Okay, this is air going into the engine. This is just fresh air, and this is air going to the bubbler. Okay. Air management valve, AMV, for large engines. This is a design of the multiple butterfly valve assembly. Two valves regulate fresh filtered air, one to the engine A and the other to the bubbler B. Excuse me. The third valve controls the flow of new fuel or GEET gas, F, from the reaction chamber to the engine. The three valves are linked together with adjustable linkage levers. These are the adjustable linkage levers right here. This is adjustable as well. Example: a connecting rod from the bubbler lever hole number 5 could be connected to the hole number 1 on the air lever, and another rod continues onto a hole on the fuel lever. Adjust all butterfly valves until they operate properly together. All three holes should be 1.25 to 1.5 inch in diameter for a 350 to 460 cubic inch diameter engine. Butterfly valve plates and shafts should be available at automotive stores for this size. An additional butterfly valve, as shown on the other sheet, may be placed in the upper portion of the air, A, channel as a delayed function butterfly that opens slower to try and maintain constant vacuum levels in the bubbler and reaction chamber. Side view. Backside view. Note, a spring to hold back the delay valve can be used instead of the shock absorber. So this is just showing a small spring here. This is spring, and this is showing shock absorber. This is end view. I believe this is looking into the pipe. Delayed butterfly, air valve lever. Here's a spring. Okay. Large engine air management valve supplement, the delayed valve. To help maintain a better vacuum in the bubbler and reaction chamber, an additional butterfly valve can be incorporated in the upper part of the air channel A of the air management valve. This butterfly valve will be set up as a delayed action valve, which means it will open slower than the valve below it. A spring connecting the two air valve levers together will be the force trying to open the delay valve to create a resistive force. To slow the delay valve from opening, a small shock absorber from a hobby shop can be used. I'm sorry, I believe I already read this. I'll read it again though. An alternate way of creating this resistive force would be to use an additional spring connecting from an area above the delay valve and connecting to the delay lever. Excuse me. As the lower air valve opens up, the first spring will try to pull the upper delay valve open, while the spring above the valve resists or slows the valve from opening. Finding the proper tension springs would be critical. This is a top view again. Intake adapter plate. Okay. We saw that. I believe we saw that above. Okay, final notes. This is inventor Paul Pantone. He is the inventor of GEET, Global Environmental Energy Technology. As a side note, Paul Pantone made the plans for the small engine, 10 horsepower and smaller, available for free. In the year 2000, 1999, actually, just in case there was any power outages for the new millennia, as we're thought to have be a possibility at that time by many people. Paul made the system available for small engines, generators 10 horsepower and smaller, because this way people can run their generators on used engine oil, used transmission fluid, just about any kind of fuel, and even mixtures of water as well, up to 80% water. Excuse me. And that's tap water as well. Nothing, no, not a special water. So that was very, I thought that was very kind of Paul, and I think Paul's quite an incredible person. I don't know a lot about his personal life, hardly at all, but as an inventor, I think he's brilliant. That's my personal belief, based on everything I've read and studied, that he's a brilliant man, has a brilliant mind. Okay, final notes. That was my personal thoughts. Final notes. Some final words to help you on your way. Fuel injection. This section has been discontinued until sufficient testing, sufficient testing and research into the fuel injection retrofit application is completed, enabling us to provide a better explanation of the procedures used for the retrofit. Also left out of these plans was previously given information on the use of propane mixer carburetors as the air management valve. We feel that because of their expensive cost and ineffectiveness to high heat conditions, they should not be addressed. Putting it all together. Big, small, or someplace in between, all of the necessary elements must come together into a usable package. To review, there are three sub-assemblies: the phase change mechanism, which is a bubbler, or a modified carburetor, the reaction chamber, where the magic happens, the air management valve, which controls the fuel-air ratio and engine speed. Certain things cannot be related on paper. You will learn more by running the engine for the first time than you could be taught on 100 pages of print. Excuse me. Remember, don't hesitate to call with your questions. We would rather spend 15 minutes on the phone and have you get it right than being frustrated and unhappy with our products. Summary. Believe it or not, the basic GEET system isn't too overly critical of sizes and dimensions. It is extremely critical of vacuum locale if things aren't working well for you. Check for any vacuum leaks. Start out on something small. Start out with manual controls and learn how the GEET works. Don't hesitate to call, fax, or email your questions. Good luck. Inventor profile. Paul Pantone, GEET Research. Paul Pantone began working on the original concept of better mileage over 20 years ago. Now, I believe this was written... This is copyright 98 to 2001, so this is 10 years ago that this was written. So, Paul Pantone began working on the original concept of better mileage over 20 years ago. So that's now over 30 years ago, and I believe it's 34 years now, as of 2011. That's my personal, what I've read on other information that I've read on other sites, information sites. Let me start over. Paul Pantone began working on the original concept of better mileage over 20 years ago. During the 20 years of testing and research, he was able to achieve the goals of zero pollution while running internal combustion engines on fuels such as crude oil, battery acid, cleaning solvents, even gasoline. Some of the tests were done with mixtures with as much as 80% water, and that's regular tap water, by the way. Having demonstrated the GEET fuel processor countless times, Paul has heard over and over that it's impossible. Most scientists who have been invited to help in this project refuse to even come out to look at it, claiming it is impossible. Yet Paul has steadfastly held his ground and continued his work. Paul, a self-taught accomplished inventor, has invented such things as a 25 caliber log splitter and an instant paint in a powder form, with over 400 different inventions under his belt. He is skeptical about the patent system. Patent searches required before filing are very costly, and once a patent is issued, the entire world can see how and why your device works. The competitors can scramble in to change just one or two small components, or even just the word, then claim patent protection for their invention. He's had some startling encounters with attorneys over the years. Several patent attorneys were consulted for this technology. Two of the patent attorneys got greedy and tried to run the business. One patent attorney attempted to file a patent for another party using a prototype stolen from Paul less than a year after being hired to represent Mr. Pantone. It is situations of this type that have made Paul so gun-shy that he wants little or no input to his actions. If you want to help work with Paul, you must put your proposal in writing or allow it to be recorded. He records many hours of information and conversations. Knowing the party offering would never be truthful otherwise, Paul Pantone has dedicated his life to clean up this planet for our children. In the end, it is only public awareness that this technology does exist that will provide the needed impetus to begin cleaning up the planet and is needed to get it to the world. As a side note that I would like to say is I highly recommend building, if you have a small engine like a lawnmower engine or just any four cycle engine, which is an engine that does not require mixing oil with the gasoline, just an engine that requires just gasoline to run on. Some two-stroke engines require that you mix oil with the gasoline. That's a different type of engine. If you have it's called a four-cycle engine, just basically a lawnmower engine. It doesn't matter how old it is, as long as it has compression and spark. This is just me, the person speaking right now, telling you my own opinion. I highly recommend going to the GEET International homepage, and there's free plans there to convert a small engine over to the GEET system, which is the Global Environmental Energy Technology Fuel Processor. And you can experiment with running the engine off a mixture of water and oil, or just running pure used engine oil, old gas mixed with oil, mixed with anything else you want to put in there. People put pickle juice, Coca-Cola, Mountain Dew. As long as there's a little bit of gasoline mixed in there, I believe it's like 10% minimum, or 20% minimum, 10 or 20%, something like that, one of those numbers. Just mixed up. There's a lot of people that have successfully, there's millions of people that are running these engines all over the world. They do work, and I wanted to read this for everyone, because when I started studying this technology, I found it to be difficult to understand at first, and even now I have a lot of questions, but I thought it would be nice to help share with everyone more about this technology. I was surprised that I hadn't heard of it before. But now that I've heard about it, it's actually quite popular. No one I knew had heard of it. But I certainly share with everyone I know that this technology exists, and I'm working with several friends to convert lawnmowers over and small engines over, which I'll also be making videos of, running the engines on different fuels. So this design will increase efficiency. It will reduce pollution, and those are two big things. That's very big. And you'll have also more power, at least the same power, and more power if the system is designed properly, if you build it correctly. I recommend working directly with Paul Pantone, and he is willing to work with anyone. I don't know if he'll work with anyone, but I know that he invites anyone interested to contact him. I don't know much about the school. I know there's a school. There's schools. There's people that are becoming dealers to sell this technology. I don't know much about what's happening with all that. I'm just focused on learning the technology, understanding the technology the best I can. But the way I see it is, even with my limited understanding of this technology, if it works, that's what counts. If I put it on my car and my gas mileage improves, even by a couple miles per gallon, and the pollution coming out the exhaust system is less than it was, that's all I need. And I will be doing a smog test on the car before and after the system is installed to see what the difference is in pollution. I want to know exactly what each parts per million of each, you know, pollutant or air pollutant or poison or whatever we want to call it, CO2 and carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, all the different, you know, chemicals that are coming out the exhaust. I want a measurement of what's coming out now and what's coming out after the GEET system is installed. This technology has been around for, let's see, about 34 years now. Paul began working on this. I know it said just over 20 years, but this was written in 98 to 2001, so that's 10 years right there. And I read that he's been doing this for 34 years. I know he's completely dedicated to perfecting the technology, and he's always researching and teaching and learning himself. So I hope this information is helpful to everyone that is interested in learning about alternative fuel vehicles. I know in comments people often ask, what does doing this to the engine do to the engine? What does it do? Is it good? Is it bad? Does it give more miles per gallon? Does it pollute more or less? And the answer is, because the system, even if the system is not designed correctly, you're still running the engine off of vapors. And that alone will increase fuel efficiency. Now, if the system's designed correctly, based on what Paul has said, and what we've just now seen in this entire series of videos that I just made, I'm not sure how many different videos this is going to be. It might be a part 1, 2, and 3, or several parts, or maybe one long video. I'm not sure yet how I can get it on there, but when the system's built correctly, that's when you get maximum efficiency. And the exhaust temperature is said to be the same as the ambient temperature. Like right now, our exhaust is very hot when in our cars, but the exhaust coming out of a GEET engine that's been converted or had the GEET system, fuel system put on, the exhaust is basically room temperature, whatever that may be, whatever the atmospheric temperature is. There's also an increase in the release of oxygen, which, as I understand it, the oxygen is being released from the fuel and from the liquids that are being used as fuel. So a 2% increase, I've read from a 2% up to I also read up to a 7% increase in oxygen. And that's 2% up to 7% more oxygen than the air that we're breathing right now. So it's actually creating oxygen almost. Not creating it, but it's releasing it from the fuels. That's what it's doing. That's my understanding of what's happening. So this is all for information or for informational purposes only. And I hope it's helpful. And feel free to share your experiences with this process. If you have already worked on these systems yourself and not had any luck in getting it to work correctly, I highly recommend that you contact Paul Pantone directly, or anyone that he recommends you work with. Maybe he can direct you to someone that can help you. Maybe some of his graduate students that are already out in the field helping people. I know he's always teaching how GEET works and how to build GEET to students. The system does work. It just has to be built correctly. You'll notice that in this in these notes here, in these pages, there was some measurements that were left out. That's because he wants you to contact him. He wants you to go through the educational process with him so that he can guide you. I believe that's my personal viewpoint, opinion of what is taking place. If you Google search, if you YouTube search GEET, G-E-E-T, you'll find many, many engines working very well with this system, and it's great. I think it's a great thing. It's a good thing. I hope this video was helpful to you, and again, please feel free to leave comments about your experiences with your fuel, alternative fuel experiments, and I look forward to hearing from you. Have a good day.